Good afternoon, everybody. So I'm going to, it's a very, you know, it's a topic where we tend to be, you know, casual about. We say ki hum jo padha rahe hain, dekh rahe hain, sab theek ho raha hai. But I'll be talking about, you know, actual evaluation strategies in the PG training, what, at least what we should aim for. So learning and assessment go hand in hand. So basically, you can assess what you have taught. So the assessment method should be compatible with the training objectives. So you can only assess your postgraduate on what you have been teaching him or her. So for that, you have to ensure the quality of training. So first and foremost, your training has to be like really good for you to expect any, you know, good assessment of what you have been, or what the PG has been doing. Ultimate goal of training and assessment is delivery of best eye care. Basically, you're training your postgraduate to deliver the best eye care that he or she could. So what is the aim of a PG educational program? What do you aim for? You want to make your postgraduate competent to diagnose, to treat, and to manage the most common conditions with minimal error. There should be minimal error in doing these are the basic things. He or she should have a good decision making and you know, a fair amount of surgical skills. You also assess him on his dissertation or the research he or she does. And it is just not you know, the clinical part, it's also professionalism and ethics. This is also part of the curriculum that you should be teaching and assessing your postgraduate on. You know, everything, whatever he or she is doing should be ethical, should be professional. This is part of your teaching, for your training. Good communication, that is also essential with your colleagues as well as the patients. Leadership, eventually, your postgraduate will become, you know, your colleague, and he or she may have the same, you know, responsibility of allocating resources, the money, and time, you know, to differentiate, you know, how much time to spend on teaching again or your clinical practice. Social accountability. This is also what you need to teach and assess your postgraduate on. You know, as a doctor, you are not there just to look at the money. You have to, you know, serve the society as well. You should teach him or her that too. And a basic understanding of the system based practice. So the assessment methods are basically of two types. One is the formative feedback. Formative as in it's a assessment designed to improve the performance and which is shared with the resident. It is a very concrete feedback. Matlab, you're examining what your postgraduate is doing and telling him this is where you're going wrong. Whereas a summative feedback is, you're just passing or failing a candidate. So throughout the year, ideally, a formative feedback should be done. As in, you keep examining and assessing your postgraduate and keep giving him the feedback so that he has further improvement. Passing and failing is, sometimes this is all, at least in our times, this is all we had, you know, all 3 years we, in our MS ophthalmology, we just work and in the end you just pass or fail. There's nobody, no concrete way to really judge whether you're doing well or not as a postgraduate. So this is, eventually you can do a summative feedback, but formative feedback is what one needs to really, really focus on. So what is the aim of a formative feedback? You have to give your postgraduate timely, specific, constructive, and fair feedback on the basis of the examination results. You have to, you can't just tell a postgraduate that you're a duffer, you can't do this. That's just not right. You have to, all this aims to be, you know, you have to aim at a constructive interaction. Everything should promote learning. The postgraduate should not be so disheartened that he feels like leaving, you know. You have to tell him where he or she needs to improve. So that should be the aim of your assessment. It has to be a fair feedback and a constructive one. So by assessing correctly, you're also assuring your own program has a, you know, a certain level of quality or excellence, your own teaching program. If you're teaching right, if you're assessing right, that's how your program becomes a, you know, it rises in excellence. But to assess, you should have these basic things, like you should have a certain standard of structure. That means you should have a relevant, you should have all the relevant equipment. You cannot assess your postgraduate on something that he's never seen. Like, for example, in some places there is no OCT. You can't assess him on his knowledge in OCT if he's never seen one or never touched one. Or if there is no operating theater, or if he doesn't know what a HEPA filter is, he doesn't know, you know, what you do, how to drape, all these things. And also, you know, having the you know, right number of faculty is also very important. Then you should have a standard of process. You should, you can't say ki aaj ye kar lo, wo kar lo. You should have a roster. You should have postings. You should have you know, definite study modules. You know, postings in each of the subspecialties, or you know, you can have a module according to your own institution. Then only you can have a certain, you can achieve certain standard of achievement. So it all depends on you know, it's all correlated. And there are so many methods you can really assess. The PGs can, you know, do a self-assessment. You can have, you know, you can have fixed days for debates or quiz or group discussions. They have debates amongst themselves. They form two groups. They would know, you know, how much they really know or not know. You can have whole quizzes for them. This is for their own knowledge, self-assessment, or assessment by your own teacher, as in the faculty, by having routine exams, oral or case presentation, journal, even journal clubs. You can assess how much the how much your PG is, you know, really doing. All this is very objective. It's not a, I mean, it's not like if you like a PG, you assess this way, or it should be all objective. And the last is, of course, assessment by outside experts. So the DNB actually holds a, is doing a fair enough job by holding, you know, routine examinations, yearly, just FAT exams where the outside experts are called, or in a, you know, the PGs go elsewhere. So that at least they themselves know how well or not so well they are doing. So the ICO, as we all know, the ICO guidelines are, you know, they are a benchmark to follow. The ICO puts a lot of guidelines. If we can see the basically every teaching institute should follow some guidelines. These the guidelines given by the ICO may or may not suit your institute, so they can be adapted to the local needs. On what kind of patients you are seeing, what kind of you know, equipment you have, how much faculty you have, it can be adapted to the local needs. But you need, definitely need to follow some guidelines. It can't be just vague. So there are a lot of these you know, exercises, which, I mean, the rubrics which have been there now, followed by some institutions. You know, OSEX is a popular one which a lot of people are talking about. That's the ophthalmic clinical evaluation exercise. It is an observed encounter between a resident and a new patient. And ideally, the evaluator who should be present in the exam room for the entire interaction. But you see your postgraduate interacting with the patient and you mark him on there. There's a form over there which you know, rates the postgraduate on his whether he meets the expectations or not. And the exercise of all this is to see whether he's able to make a diagnosis and be, make a plan of what he has needs to do with a patient, whether he is capable of doing that or not. So this is also a very objective assessment, clinical assessment. Then we all know about these OSCAR, the ophthalmology surgical competency assessment rubric. The ICO OSCARs are all there on the internet. There you have OSCARs for SICA, SWECO. Basically in this, there are, you evaluate every step. Ideally, as going through the last session, you sit with the postgraduate and you evaluate him on every step that he's doing. The incision, the CCC, the FACO, the IA, and you assess him at the beginning of his posting and you assess him at the end of the posting, and it's sort of, you see the progress, what he's making. Then only, ideally, you should give him an independent, you have to be there to assess him, and then he and you both will feel more confident in his doing independent surgeries. There are OSCARs for a lot of surgeries, SICS, FACO, pediatric cataract surgery, squint, whatever, according to your local needs, you can, you know, teach the postgraduate. They're also talking about video observation of procedural skills. The OSCAR is based on direct observation of procedural skills. That is, the teacher is sitting with the postgraduate to really observe what he's doing. But the other option is the video observation. You make a video of the postgraduate operating, and then you judge him on that. Then you, this is more convenient, and you can have multiple assessors. And a lot of places, no, some of places, not all, not, but some places have surgical simulators, as in you can, there are surgical procedures on pig eyes or eyesight simulator. If there is there are not enough patients, you can teach and assess your postgraduate on that. And you have other similar kind of rubrics like OSS, which is an objective assessment of intraocular surgery, or GRASS, that is, you know, behaviorally anchored rubric, means preoperative knowledge, microscope use, instrument handling, and others which are used by different universities. So the take-home message is that you need to follow some guidelines. They have to be objective. They have to be constructive. You want to see your postgraduate like really do well, be a good ophthalmologist. I mean, that's what will give you maximum pleasure, and that's what is going to make your postgraduates happy too. Thank you. So this is our batch of DNB at Eye Care. Thank you.
Anybody wants to comment on this talk? Or shall we go ahead with the next talks? Dr. Nandita Chaturvedi?
Can I ask the next speaker?
Yeah, and the next speaker is Dr. Tani Natung. Can you be there at the other podium?
Good afternoon, all. I would like to thank the IOS Scientific Committee for giving me this opportunity. So I'm going to talk about the topic whether residents should no longer be taught ECC or SICS, and I agree with this topic. So first point is that only once we get out into practice, out of our residency, basically only phacoemulsification is being performed. Gone are the days when camp patients were satisfied ki we are coming in camp, we are not paying, so we can, so SICS or sutured surgery will be acceptable to us. All patients are now largely aware about phacoemulsification surgery, and they all want the best of facility. So once this is the only surgery that is being performed in practical life, so we might as well go ahead and learn what we are going to do. And this is the era of wet labs, so there is the earlier principle that first we learn ECC or SICS and then we'll progress stepwise to phacoemulsification. Now we have wet labs, so we can learn the steps of phacoemulsification directly in the wet labs and then progress to actual patients. Similarly, older strategies, it is the rule of life that things, when they become redundant, they have to be disposed with. Like ICC was the standard earlier on when surgeries were started, and eventually it was done away with. So now so many newer advances have come, and rather than starting from ECC, then going to SICS, then FACO, and so on and so forth, we should rather give our residents the best advantage, start with FACO, and then by the end of their tenure or later on after the residency, they're well prepared with FACO so they can go on to the more advanced techniques more easily, rather than spending time on learning FACO itself. Thirdly, because in India, and I think I can speak for medical colleges, not the big institutes, the faculty is very restricted. The optimum amount of faculty is not available. So the amount of time that can be spent on actually training the residents may not be as much as is desirable, and if we waste that time in teaching them ECC, SICS, and then teach them, acha, now you progress to this step of FACO, Rather than that, if we start teaching them FACO on the wet lab, on simulation softwares, and then go on to teach them FACO steps right away in the actual patients. So as also said by Dr. Shahid Alam in the previous set of lectures, that the patients who are, the residents who are performing FACO by the end of the residency is very few, it's abysmally low. So if we are actually teaching them FACO right from the beginning, we may be able to improve this data. And more residents may be able to perform independent FACOs by the time they finish their surgical training. And there have been a few studies in Greece, I'm sorry I don't have the reference right now, which showed that progressing to FACO in a step-by-step manner after doing SACS was less advantageous to the residents as a surgeon rather than directly beginning the steps of FACO emulsification surgery and learning the correct way to do FACO right from the beginning. Thank you so much for your time.
Let's invite Dr. Tani Natung to give a counter and then we'll have a discussion on that.
Good afternoon, everyone. Thank you for giving me this opportunity. So I disagree with the statement that there is no need to teach ECC and SACS to residents because it's not performed in practice. I'm Dr. Natung from NAGRIMS Shillong. We should aim for the best, but be prepared for the worst. We have all heard of the FACO nightmares, which is much more commoner for the beginners. And if a PCR is noted early in the FACO surgery where the bulk of nucleus is remaining, further FACO surgery may be extremely dangerous. If a resident not knowing ECC or SICS is in such a situation, what will he or she do? If the capsular axis runs out to the periphery, especially in cataracts like intumescent cataract, what will a resident do? Doing FACO in such situations will be fraught with complications. So in these cases, converting to SICS or ECC will be the answers to our prayers. What if the residents get pre-existing complicated cases like cataracts with loose zonules or large subluxated cataract? Doing FACO will surely lead to complications, and ECC or SICS will be the solution. Not all hard or very hard cataracts can be done by FACO emulsification. This can be better handled with SICS or ECCE with equally good visual outcome. And cataract, some cataracts are associated with corneal opacities where visualization of inner structure is compromised. And FACO may be difficult. Here also SICS or ECC will come handy. We often get cases of aphakia where SFIOL implantation is required. To do this, one must know the technique of SICS. If a FACO machine stops functioning in the middle of a surgery, then what? Not all hospitals will have a backup machine. What will residents do in such cases? SICS again or ECC will bail them out. Now, not all residents after passing out will be practicing in a center with FACO emulsifier facility. If one does not learn ECC or SICS, what will he or she do then? If one learns these techniques, they can still do cataract cases. FACO surgery has steep learning curves and are more prone for complications and thereby litigations. ECC or SICS give the basic idea of the nitty-gritty of a cataract surgery, and these prime and prepare the residents for FACO surgery. Hence, the step-by-step approach is better. We should again weigh the visual outcome versus the learning outcome. Cost obviously matters. FACO is becoming the standard of care, yet many patients in India cannot pay for FACO procedure. And also many surgeons also cannot afford the FACO machine and its running cost. SACS is more affordable and is for high volume surgeries. This brings us to NPCVI, which mandates that high volume cataract surgeries be done to control the preventable blindness in India. SACS is favored for this program for cost cutting and high volume surgeries. Residents knowing these procedures can contribute immensely to this national program. The art of trabeculectomy. Residency is not just about cataract. SACS prime the residents to the technique of trabeculectomy. A scleral tunneling making is similar. There are studies which are in favor of SACS or ECCE. This is done in Irvine Eye Hospital where they found out that overall complications in FACO is much higher than SACS, and they have recommended that SACS may be a safer initial procedure to learn in inexperienced cataract surgeons in the developing world. There's a study review here done. They also have stated that SACS or ECC occupies an important place in modern cataract surgery and should be a part of cataract surgeons' overall skill set. And to summarize, these are my points which I have elaborated, which are in favor to teach ECC and SACS. Thank you very much. I'm from Negrims. If anyone wants to visit, is welcome. Thank you so much.
I think that was a beautiful counter. Do we have any comments from the audience? Dr. Subhadra Jalani.
Thank you. I'm still called by all my great phaco surgeons to do ICC when there's a big hard nucleus lying just behind the lens because they've never done it. They don't even know how to do cryo extraction. I'm a retina surgeon, I don't do any cataract surgeries. So I just want to say that, you know, why should it be like SSCS phaco? I think in a training OR, whatever type of case comes, the surgeon and the fellow should be able to decide, is this a phaco surgery, is this a SICS surgery, and both techniques should be taught side by side. It's like, you know, when we are teaching retinal detachment surgery, we were doing a lot of buccals, yes. And now everybody does vitrectomy, but as the detachment patients come, if it's a buccal case, we teach buccal to the fellow, and we also do buccal, and if it's a vitrectomy case, so that decision of what is the best surgery for a given situation is what a good surgeon will do, rather than having a dogmatic approach that all cases we have to do only one technique. I think as many armamentariums a surgeon has, as many good, you know, deliveries can happen. So I know how to do implants. I learned that retinal implants, and I can do it very easily. And you know, very high myopes, I don't have to do vitrectomy and put them with oil. So same way, if there's a patient, like, you know, we have endophthalmitis with lens abscess. Now these patients cannot have phaco. They need SICS or they need ECC, and my residents who've never done SICS, they find it so difficult, and I can do it in 5 minutes. So they cannot do phaco in those eyes. You can't phaco a lens abscess. So I think all techniques, and we who are senior surgeons and know good techniques, we should be able to impart them to the next surgeon. Why hide one technique for the other?
I fully agree with you, madam. If a person wants to be a comprehensive cataract surgeon, he should know both, all the techniques. All the techniques. Yeah. Yes. Thank you, madam.
I have another observation. Given the comorbidity that we have, you see, there's comorbidity, there's a lot of corneal comorbidity in our cases. So they are not ideal phaco cases. So like where you have safed cornea, uske beech mein se phaco karna, ma'am, I don't know. I would have.
And visibility is a problem for surgeon. Exactly. Actually, SICS is much safer and much less traumatic to the patient also.
Less traumatic.
Even
for the
ECC
surgeon
also. Well, yeah.
Also, the residents these days don't know how to suture also.
Exactly. Yeah. Unless you do ECC, suturing will not. They will not. Yeah.
Just a continuation on that white corneas. I call them Bob cataracts, blindly operating the blind, because you can't see what you are operating.
Bad phaco and a good SICS. So
I think the
good SICS
Dr. Daljit Singh always used to say that the second largest cause of blindness is poorly done cataract surgeries. So if you don't know how to do a good cataract surgery by any means, then you will have more blind people. Thank you. We'll start with the next. I request Dr. Preet Kanwar Singh Sodhi, and he's going to talk for RD treatment should be taught to the residents, a must. And I request Dr. Jatinder Bali present with this. Thank you.
Good afternoon all. I would like to thank ARC AIS to give me this opportunity to speak on this topic. Can I start? Vitreoretinal surgery is the most demanding subspecialty to master due to the delicate nature of retina, the myriad procedures to learn, and the need to adapt to evolving technology. Not surprisingly, the learning curve is incredibly steep. The steep road for becoming an astute, efficient, and competent VR surgeon demands endless practice, perseverance, and a compulsive attention to detail. Achieving this goal requires an active commitment. Retinal diseases have become a significant cause of low vision in every part of the world. The posterior segment complications of anterior segment surgeries are on a rise. So with the increasing burden of retinal disorders, all ophthalmologists should be trained in diagnosing and managing the common retinal conditions. Over the years, the process of surgical training has evolved from an unstructured apprenticeship of unlimited duration to a more organized Halstedian pyramidal model to the current standardized rectangular model with defined timelines. However, the essential concept of see one, do one, teach one continues to be ingrained. The Indian education system still works on the Gurukul model. The Accreditation Council for Graduate Medical Education is responsible for residency program in the US. Evaluating surgical expertise of the residents is a core competency. The number of surgeries, though reduced by ACGME of VRS as primary surgeon from 3 to 1, but still one case is mandatory. The practice patterns of VR surgery were started in US in 2008. The majority of residents had no primary buccal experience, and a significant minority had a no primary vitrectomy experience. However, a large number had an experience as an assistant surgeon. The Reed study for young ophthalmologist perception of residency programs in India concluded that it varies considerably from program to program. A nationwide survey of residency trainers showed that while the departmental heads were generally satisfied, the residents felt that their training was inadequate and perhaps incomplete. This shows the surgical exposure for retinal detachment surgery, which is almost negligible compared to the other surgeries. If you see the numbers, the observed assisted is still comparable to the other surgeries, while performed under supervision and independently are almost negligible, though present, but negligible. So a lack of standardized curriculum, limited number of faculties trained, the lack of equipment are major hiccups. Articles from IGO even say that we may be missing the wood for the trees. The hard infrastructure is in place, but perhaps not the soft skills. The Reed's Report 6 compared residency training in two generations and found that the numbers of retinal detachment and vitrectomy has decreased when they surveyed the 21st century trained ophthalmologists. A study of medical colleges by ARC of AIUS provided evidence of huge gap in infrastructure and lack of subspecialty services. Another survey of medical colleges pointed to the deficiency in academics and research. So what can be done? Quality teaching and learning can be accomplished even in the absence of state-of-art equipment by incorporating the ACGME concepts of supervised training and graded and progressive responsibility. Incorporation of the ICO OSCAR modules can make the surgical skill evaluation more objective. Subtle reorganization within the department, time management, motivating the young faculty, one-to-one mentoring of residents will go a long way. With the advent of digitally assisted VR surgery like Ingenuity, surgical virtual reality stimulators like IC, we have no reason to not teach. Exit examinations are mainly theoretical and practical exams are based on case presentations. So a robust methodology to judge the surgical skills of passing out resident is needed. Residents have a major role to play in having their training transformed into a holistic experience by incorporating the 6 ACGME elements. They should actually participate in surgical training by assisting, operating under supervision, and then independently performing. This was an article in which the fellows published their surgical retina training protocols, and they found that keeping a surgical journal, spending time reviewing videos and films, working with various faculty, discussing your complications, help in the surgical training. This was a bestseller published in 2008 by Malcolm Gladwell, who popularized the idea of the 10,000 hour rule by retrospecting evaluating the success stories of Beatles musical talents and Bill Gates. So when we know the lacunae, we know what all to do and how to do. Why not do it early? Patients are plenty, pathology is varied, teachers are vastly experienced, and students are the cream of the fraternity. So all that we need to do is a will to change and do our very best through what is possible under the given circumstances. Thank you.
Thank you so much.
We'll finish the counter and then have audience response.
Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. I'm Dr. Jatinder Bali, and I thank the organizers for giving me this opportunity to talk about RD surgery for the residents. Should it be optional or should it be voluntary? Should it be optional or should it be mandatory? And I am going to support the latter. I have no financial interests in this particular presentation. So the first thing we did was we did a snap online poll, and the results were not surprising. 90% of, almost 90% of the residents as well as the practitioners, they felt that this was an essential part of training, and this included practitioners in anterior segment as well as in the posterior segment. Of course, all of us know there are three different types of surgeries that we are practicing for retinal detachment. And for paucity of time, I'm going to focus on vitrectomy mainly, and then I'll just touch upon the latter two. So what? Now let us look at the Indian scenario. You see, we have 530, 540 odd medical colleges. Out of this, 240 medical colleges are licensed to run MS ophthalmology courses. The total annual intake is around 1,000 odd. In addition, we have diploma courses and we have DNB seats. The sum total of all these seats gives us 1,500 ophthalmic surgeons every year. Now let us dissect it a little further. Out of these 540 odd medical colleges, only 8% or 40 odd medical colleges have fully functional retinal setups. So that means we're looking at 200 institutions which do not have access to it. Then we went back and we said, let's look at the costing data. Now, a VR surgery in the US costs around $4,000. In India, we're charging around $500, $550. But look at the cost of the consumables there. They're costing $250 to $450 across the board. The per capita GDP of India is 2,000 odd US dollars, and out of this, we're spending around 1.5% on our healthcare. The US spends 18% of its GDP on healthcare. In addition, what is the problem we have in India? We do not have a robust referral system, forwards or backwards. The distances are shrinking because of better roads and better transport, and ambulatory patients can move from one center to the other. So when we look at the costs of acquiring and maintaining this expensive equipment, along with the costs of obsolescence and the recurring costs associated with every surgery, I think it's going to be very difficult to sell this proposition to the policymakers or to any government to increase the outlay. Yes, we are a large market for these devices and machines. Yes, we do want the training for the surgery. The question that we need to answer here today is, can we afford it? And the answer to my mind is that unless we drastically increase the outlay to this sector, or we drastically decrease the cost per surgery, I think it's a pipe dream that we're talking of. That is why we should keep it as optional. Because if we make it mandatory, there's going to be fudging of data because we have to award those degrees. And all that training is going to remain on paper only. And we will be training generations of liars. That having been said, there is scope for pneumatic retinopexy and scleral buckling. And that, I think, should be made available to each and every trainee, wherever possible. In addition, there is a need to deprecate this move towards trying to award MCH and vitreoretina. Because what it is going to do is, it is going to further rarefy the already limited facilities and decrease the demand for the machines as well as the devices. What we need is a win-win situation for everybody and not a win-lose. What we need is sabka saath, sabka vikas. We want it. Can we afford it? Is the answer that we need to answer today. Thank you.
Thank you. Sir, may I have your opinion? You're going to make a point. Yep.
I just wanted to say, the earlier speaker told that there should be surgical skill should also be tested during examinations. Actually, that is very difficult. Our teacher used to say earlier there was provision
which was abolished. Because the student who is appearing in the exam is quite tense. And by the way, during tensions, a little bit problem also he creates, he stands failed in surgical skills. So it is very difficult to undergo surgical skill during examination. That is my point.
I think, sir, you have a very valid point. The reason being, see, every exam, every test, a summative assessment that we want to make should be replicable. And unfortunately, surgeries are not replicable. There is a large biologic variability. Every surgery is different. So I am, yes, if you were using simulators, yes, use it on simulators. Test the person on simulators.
And you can test on simulators because simulators are going to be coming in a big way in next decade. So we can test students on simulators.
My only point is we are giving MS, Master of Surgery. The resident goes through without getting surgical training. I would only like to advise or suggest it should be taught in the curriculum. If not in the exit exam, at least in the curriculum. That's the least we want as residents.
Actually,
they're all on paper, sir.
So the way to assess the surgical skill need not be necessary during the exam.
Exactly.
You can ask the fellow to show you 5 of his surgical videos,
exactly,
which have been, you know, signed off by the faculty. So there are other ways that, you know, like in schools also now we don't ask everything during the exam.
Exactly.
Because that has been understood that during the exam you cannot assess. So it is a continuous evaluation. So same way for the surgical skills, if we really want to examine a candidate for surgical skills, we have the means, you know, you show your first video, show your fourth video, show your 10th video. So you, there are ways to, you know, assess. It's not that on the exam day they should be assessed. So parts of the things should be assessed.
We can assess on simulators, madam. Yep. And simulator can give a score also.
The candidate is supposed to have done the surgery. So they should have the
He can show videos, but he may not have done the surgery.
So I have
You will know whether it's a fellow doing or a faculty doing. How much you can fudge, then you can fudge.
Ma'am, I have a small query. Why do we need to assess it in the first place?
Because the person is going to be a surgeon.
And
if
independent
person is
surgeon.
Going to be
independent
an independent surgeon, and that will also put a pressure on the teachers.
Ma'am, so don't you think it should be part of the formative assessment?
That's
every 6 months, he
exactly.
gives us a formative assessment
exactly.
on the simulator.
Exactly.
Rather than have it as a summative assessment at the end of the end of 3 years, you come and you operate. So that's
very come and operate during exam is, I think, very, very unethical for the patient.
Agreed. Agreed.
That everybody has agreed, and I think that has stopped, and it's rightly stopped.
Yeah.
Same way, like, you know, life surgeries. So that is stopped. But the formative assessments periodically and being measured on those are very, very critical. That will put a pressure on the teachers and the learner that I need to deliver and I need to perform. And it has to be a continuous learning process. And we can see whether the person has improved or not, you know, by the continuous improvement.
Yeah. Thank you, madam. Can we have a...
The ICO Oscar is pretty good if you look at the terms.
Yeah.
If you really look at it, it's very good because every step is you mark it. It's an objective thing every time, but it's a direct observation. You have to sit with the postgraduate and do it. Second way is the video assistant. You can record and you can assess it.
Yes.
There are ways to do it, but it's not just one time.
It's a continuing process. Yeah, point well taken. We are running short of time, so can we have next debate, please? Can we have Dr. Priyanka Sodhwani, who is going to talk for FACO training for residents? And Dr. Pratik Shah? No, that was ECC, SICS and FACO. No, this is FACO and FACO. Yes and no. Can we start? Yeah, please.
A very good afternoon. Today I will be speaking on FACO emulsification is must for residents. In this fast-paced, high-tech world of modern ophthalmology, there is a continuous change and advancement in the field of investigations and microsurgical techniques. The patient awareness is to that extent that he knows the surgical procedure, he knows about the machine, and he knows about the IOL before he visits an ophthalmologist. Residency program has not kept pace with the advances. It still focuses on ECC and manual SICS only. Few teachers feel that PG should begin from ECC and have the feel of the tissue and then switch over to FACO emulsification so that he should be first expert in ECC and SICS and then go for FACO emulsification. There are few studies that step by step, if phacoemulsification is done, then complication rates are decreased. Today we have wet lab systems, surgical simulators, postmortem human eyes and animal eyes to learn and practice phaco in a stress-free environment, to get familiar with machine settings, microscopes, microsurgical techniques. We can also practice suturing techniques also to avoid disaster or disaster management in phaco. Now, a postgraduate after completing MBBS and 3 years of his intensive training in ophthalmology lands himself in the field lost. At an age of 27 to 29 years, he is still incapable of learning as he is not knowing the basic technique of phacoemulsification. He has landed in a field where masters of phaco are established. And not every pass-out PG has an opportunity to go for a fellowship or a training program. His confidence is decreased when the patient asks he wants phaco surgery. He becomes depressed and many land up as non-operating ophthalmologists. And we do not want this. Our aim is to make a competent world leaders. A postgraduate has maximum enthusiasm to learn new technique. He is devoted towards learning without any distractions, and he is most receptive at this time for gaining new knowledge stepwise and efficiently and not in a hurry and without stress. And in a PG institute, there is maximum patient load, maximum exposure, and most important, it's a teaching institute. So why not teach an advanced technique to a postgraduate? In 3 years of residency, I'm not saying that he will master phaco, but he should be well versed with machine dynamics, settings, foot pedal control, and various steps of surgery, so that when he lands in the field of practice, individual or institutional should be confident enough to start a surgery. To conclude, we as teachers, if this can only be achieved when we as teachers are well versed with the surgical technique. Presently, few institutes are there for training, but because of time constraints or not every faculty can go for training. So if a trainer visits different postgraduate institutes and train every faculty of the hierarchy, irrespective of their previous trainings, because hierarchy is there in our all institutes, and it is necessary each and every faculty should be trained, and then we could definitely attain this target of training postgraduates in phacoemulsification. Thank you.
Now, Dr. Pratik Shah, please.
Yeah, good noon, all of you.
Requesting the next set of speakers, Dr. Savleen Kaur and Dr. Amar Pujari to be ready. We will cut short the discussion on this one in the interest of time. We are running about half an hour late. And it's sort of very similar to the first debate.
So very good noon, all of you. So when we tell it phaco for the resident, if it is a compulsory, then it is something like we are telling that each and every town, each and every village should must have the air connectivity. If there is a no air connectivity, people should not stay there. It cannot be like that. Practically, it is not possible. Surgical training of the resident generally starts in a step-by-step manner. It starts with a block room, then observation, then surgical steps. And basically, when the resident enters in the ophthalmology OT, most of them are surgically naive. They never had this microscopic exposure. So and again, most of the residents which are operating on the patients, most of them are the community patients, and many of them having a mature or near mature cataract. Now, motto during our training is that no harm to the patient, and that is the baseline. Now, when we start with a MSICS, manual SICS, there are many advantages. One is that it is a widespread, commonly used, age-old proven technique. It doesn't require any specific infrastructure. There is no active fluidics and easy to learn. And steps of SICS has a great similarity with those of the phaco. And hence, learning of the phaco skill later on is really easy if they know SICS. So basically, Well, I personally prefer my residents to start with MICCS, and depending on their scale, later on they can move on the FACO if needed. Now, FACO fluidics again to learn is really an important task. Even a single improper side port can create your surgery mess, and foot pedal control that again needs a proper training. So basically, and foot pedal control generally instructor don't have direct eye. So if we are directly giving the FACO, then it is again one of the important challenge for the trainer also. Now, so reasonable way is if we are starting with MICCS and depending on the caliber of the resident, you move on, and that should be within the curriculum. Now here, curriculum is not about the cataract surgery. Your curriculum is about ophthalmology, and residents are like a pluripotent cells. They can divert in all the specialties and they can decide their further path. Now, as a teacher, our responsibility is to show them this wide horizon beyond the cataract surgery also. Now, each and every resident has a different learning curve. We are also having the resident which have a huge gap in their career. Some of them became pregnant, some of them stop in between, some of them are struggling for the choice. And many times the residents are coming who are somewhat lesser, slower learning.
No.
Now if we look at the setup in the ophthalmology, there are still institutes where the FACO machine is still a luxury and it is not easily available. This is even in fact, after the NPCB and Vision 2020, many institutes just recently got the FACO and all those upgradation of the department. And in fact, those places where already upgradation is there, many faculties are still under training or they are just taking the safe cases. Now, what about the residents of those colleges? Curriculum has to be some standardized. It suggests that there should be some least required skills that has to be there and not all the skills. Again, if we include the FACO in a curriculum, then challenges are there because FACO opens the wide horizon again. FACO in the mature cataract, FACO in the small pupil, and this all we can't cover during the MS of the 3 years, which requires really huge experience. So a real scenario, if we will look, we can't give the FACO to FACO training to each and every resident. So we are doing injustice to some part. Now, unfortunate reality is that when I'm sitting in a tertiary care center, many times I'm getting a postgraduate, a post-MS candidate who are still not confident in MSICS or forget about the surgical skill. If I'm telling them to do the proper IO, they are sometimes not confident enough. Now, we should create a troubleshooter. Rather than focusing only on FACO, focus on giving a good thorough exposure of how can they minimize their complication, how can they tackle their complication, all subspecialty knowledge. So my take home message is, if you are able to teach the FACO, it is good. But if you can't, we can't stop the residency program. Learning is a constant process, and if you can't teach the FACO during the residency, they can learn it later on also. But it can be the optional, not the mandatory. Thank you.
Thank you very much. You have beautifully set up the discussion for the next set of participants on subspecialty exposure.
Later, sir, because we are running short of time. Actually, we are late by half an hour.
Good afternoon, everyone. We are now talking about resident specialty surgical training, and I'm going to speak for it. I read a quote, "Being an ophthalmologist is easy," by a resident. It's like riding a bike, except the bike is on fire. You are on fire. Everything is on fire. So imagine the amount of stress that a resident has to undergo because ophthalmology has become so broad that it is almost impossible to be on the cutting edge of every subspecialty. At the end of the 3 years, when we take their exam, we expect them to be an all-rounder, a hero who can dance, who can smile, who can laugh. So they have to be an all-rounder in ophthalmology also. Imagine the amount of stress we are putting on them to have a master or a master of knowledge of surgery of every subspecialty. They are at such crossroads that they actually think, do I need to subspecialize with a fellowship? Could I see myself practicing a career as ophthalmology? What if I want to go back to my rural setting or I want to practice the flexible comprehensive ophthalmology in a semi-urban setting? Subspecialty training is now the need of the hour. And I propose that we have a microsurgical training curriculum instead of a cataract surgical training program alone. We do not want to produce an MS in retina or a person, a hyper resident who just wants to do cataract surgeries and go away and we give them an MS in cataract degree. We want to give them an MS in ophthalmology. previous speakers have very nicely highlighted that in terms of subspecialty training, we must rotate the residents through various subspecialties. Why not rotate them surgically as well? They might not be expected to learn the whole subspecialty procedure, but exposure to subspecialty surgeries will ultimately sharpen their surgical acumen and their hand-eye coordination. I do not want to call them as subspecialties. They are super specialties now. That is how I like to call them. The 2-3-4 month rotation that in the so-called super specialties can be over in a blink. Some small procedures like maybe a therapeutic keratoplasty can teach them suturing, which we do not do in the phaco emulsification era. Skill development will be enhanced in any form of surgery and not just cataract surgery alone. There might be places where you have some procedural and administrative issues that you cannot do a cataract surgery and cannot give every case or offer every case of cataract to a resident. Subspecialty training is now an important role, and subspecialty surgical training should also be a part of an organized curriculum. I'm not saying this from the top of my head. There's actually literature to support this. Many studies have shown that the interest that a resident has in a particular subspecialties is actually determined by the time of exposure that the trainees have in a special field. A very interesting paper in ophthalmology 2005, where the residents actually evaluated and said that the acquisition of special skills and the role models and the mentors in a particular subspecialty area and the amount of surgery they were allowed to do actually stimulated them to take up that specific subspecialty. We might see a time where we have a lot of specialist surgeons. We might have an oversupply of specialist training. And then we would have to take some government initiatives where we want more comprehensive ophthalmologists also. Do we not want to give them a comprehensive surgical training in residency alone? Again, I would not recapitulate what my previous speakers have nicely said. We have supported vitreoretinal surgery. We have papers which support vitreoretinal surgery in residency also. And the most interesting that I came across was refractive surgery experience is also fundamental to the education of an ophthalmology resident. I would like to put some disclaimers when I say that we should do a subspecialty training and not alone. A learning curve in the subspecialty training could be steeper, so it should always be guarded and mentored. It could be taught in stages. There might be some residents who actually struggle in basic steps also, so the mentors have to decide which all residents are fit to do some specialty training under their supervision. We can give them surgery in a graded manner, first phase giving them just preparation of cases, next phase moving on to assisting them in the subspecialty, and maybe in the third phase they can be assisted by a senior faculty member. He or she can be then be proficient in some small operations, non-cataract surgery also. I would like to conclude by that we have a paper in IGO by stalwarts in ophthalmology, and they actually have a national curriculum. They propose that it is essential that residents should perform at least 50 cataract surgeries, 5 glaucoma, 5 squint, 5 eyelid surgery, 5 sac surgeries, and 5 eye retrieval surgeries to complete their MS in ophthalmology. So we need effective and validated surgical training programs to ensure that residents in training achieve greater levels of competence in ophthalmic surgery and not just cataract surgery alone. Incorporating the subspecialty training may improve the quality of ophthalmology residency training. Thank you very much.
I like the last slide.
Dr. Amar Pujari.
Dr. Amar Pujari is there? Dr. Amar Pujari?
He's not there.
I think we'll go to the next talks by ROP screening by Dr. Renu Grover. Dr. Sujit Kumar Mishra is here.
So ROP screenings for the residents. So my first argument for it is you should look at this table. So this is a summary of the important medical legal cases between 2012 and 2018 in ROP in India. And you see, there is an ophthalmologist involved here. And these are the lessons learned. Eyes WNL, no details, and no ROP. Ophthalmologist can also be held liable, no documents, what drugs used. So unfortunately, if it's whoever is there, the resident
in training or whoever is there cannot say that I don't know how to look at the retina. So I mean, I do only cataract, so this is where you land up in. So I think every resident should be able to look at the retina, do ROP screenings, how important it is. It is also, there are another paper that I read that in pediatric ophthalmology, it is the, all these litigations are never in favor of the doctor. The doctor is responsible all the time. You cannot say that I don't know how to do this. You have to be aware. The resident has to be aware. It is not so difficult to do in an IO, in a child, in a newborn child. It is easier to do an IO in a newborn child than an adult because the child doesn't. You can hold the child and do it. There is no this thing of the child being not cooperative. You can just hold him or her and do the screening. So at least I would say that every resident should know how to screen, and then maybe based on his findings can refer to somebody more experienced. The screening is a must to be taught to the residents. So we know that worldwide ROP is amongst the leading causes of childhood blindness, and early detection and timely intervention to reduce this makes screening an important aspect of ROP. So not only, I mean, timely intervention is also very important because the earlier you diagnose, the earlier you treat, that is how you save a child from going blind. And nowadays we have all these smartphone guided imaging. There are a lot of papers published on this, and I guess if you're unable to do it clinically, you can use these devices. But you should, unless you know, unless the resident knows, he cannot do this. He has to learn what is ROP, how to screen, and document. So, thank you.
Dr. Sujit will give the counter.
Tees din roshni ke. It's my privilege to be here. Thank you, Partha sir, for giving me this opportunity. And it's what else you can ask for when ma'am herself is sitting here. So ROP screening for resident, optional. One point I want to clarify, that very wisely ARC has chosen the word as must versus optional. They have not put it for or against. So by changing it to for and against, we are going against the spirit of this whole talk. And when you say optional, residents means they are yet to decide their specialty. And when you say optional, it doesn't mean you are going to stop them. It will attract those from the lot who intend to build their career in ROP management. So it leaves a very small, highly selective room for those highly motivated clinicians. You know, we need exclusively trained manpower because the target group is very fragile and premature babies. They are precious babies, as prematurity may be more common with IVF. ROP is potentially a blinding condition. Identification of a child requiring treatment for ROP has a shorter window period and a high risk of poor outcome if the diagnosis is missed. Comorbidities are there. After effects, that is visual loss, is permanent. And above all, medico-legal implications are there, as you can see in one of the articles, which says there are growing number of court cases related to retinopathy of prematurity, and the compensations may go in the tunes of crores. Look at the brochure of one of the teaching institutes, short-term training in management of retinopathy of prematurity and pediatric retinal disorder. What does the eligibility criteria say? Is any ophthalmologist who has special interest in management in ROP and pediatric retinal disorders, not just any resident. A study was conducted at Columbia University, NICU, to compare the ability to diagnose treatment warranted ROP between 14 trained non-experts and 3 retina specialists with standard examination by experienced pediatric ophthalmologists in 67 infants, and the result was diagnosis by retina specialist had 100% sensitivity and 93% specificity in comparison to residents where sensitivity and specificity was 88% and 84% respectively. India leads all countries in the number of preterm infants born annually. Of course, with more and more survival rate of premature babies, the incidence is on rise. But that doesn't mean we deploy immature clinicians to mend the immature vessels. Indian ROP Society, in 2017 published report by Winokur et al., and all the names are the face of ROP in India and internationally. 113 members were the respondents in 2017. Now, number has grown to 250 plus. And out of those respondents, 96% were comfortable with screening, 86% comfortable with treatment, and only 25.7% were comfortable with or confident with surgery. So we have a special situation where one who screens may not confidently diagnose, one who diagnoses may not treat, and the one who treats may not treat surgically. So we have to be cautious in deciding what we are adding to the bunch of healthcare providers. And think about the anxious parents. A casual approach will never build the level of confidence between clinician and the parents. So we have to decide what we want to add to this lot, a naive or a highly motivated, skilled manpower. So I strongly recommend skilled hands for these tender babies. Thank you very much.
We'll have any comments from the audience?
I think that as teachers in ophthalmology and as a residency training program, it's very important that the primary prevention programs and the basic idea information should be known to all ophthalmologists and also to all doctors. Every doctor, whether you are ophthalmologist or not, we know that a newborn baby requires a vaccination. So we may not know what vaccination, which vaccination, when it has to be done, but we are aware that in the community, if somebody asks or we go to see some newborn baby, we say, oh, how's the baby? Okay, tika lagaya ki nahi? Vaccination start working. So that information that a preterm baby needs an eye examination and this din roshni ke, this should be known to all residents. So whether the resident further trains or not, but that exposure going to the NICU, seeing a preterm baby, touching it, knowing that these babies can be touched and screened. So different people would get different information, but there's some information in preventive ophthalmology which should be known to everybody. Like, diabetic patient needs to undergo an eye examination. If you're going to do cataract surgery on a diabetic patient, I need to follow his retina and not say like, maine cataract kar diya, bhaage, jab vision kam hoga tab dekhna. So I think that primary preventive disorders, comprehensive examination and information, that should be part of every residency program. And yes, those who are good at indirect, they can be taught and then they can go further. But basic information about all the ophthalmology preventive disorders, we must teach to all the residents.
Dr. Major Parihar.
I think half of my comments has already been covered by Dr. Subhadra. We are offering degree of MS ophthalmology. Not MS in cataract surgery, refractive, means the refraction, or this thing. A comprehensive ophthalmologist has student. You may ask now, tomorrow, why the MBBS student should read embryology of limbs and brain and all. He is never going to practice that. So I don't advocate this, that I am a retina person, so I will not see cornea. I am a cornea person, I will not see the medial canthus and all those. Yeah, it is happening. So we have to inculcate our residents and faculties also. Look, a basic primary standard of all component of ophthalmic practice must be known to a person who is appearing for MS ophthal exam. I remember in 2011, I had given a thesis topic on ROP to a resident. And he did well, Anurag Badani, son of Dr. Rajendra Prasad. I think he had gone to LVP for his VR. So, and ma'am has rightly said that touch is very important. When they see the environment, they will definitely develop an interest to identify it. So I think we should not restrict by subspecialties in ophthalmology.
Thank you.
Just to add to what he's saying and what I was going to say with the RD thing earlier, what we don't understand is that the fact that when I'm talking about either oculoplasty or RD, there is something called as a undergraduate curriculum. There is something called as a postgraduate curriculum, and there's something called as a fellowship curriculum. What we've drawn, what we have been doing in our country, is that we've drawn a line. Everything is fellowship curriculum. There's nothing in undergraduate. So even as an undergraduate, I'm supposed to know Kalesion. If I may not be an oculoplastic, I may not even be an ophthalmologist, but I'm supposed to know Kalesion. I'm supposed to know lid abscess, and I'm supposed to treat that. As a ophthalmologist, I'm supposed to treat a little DCR or a DCT. As a oculoplasty, as a resident, something more. As an oculoplasty, maybe I will do oncology in those, Kalesion and all things. So the curriculum is separate, and that is what the whole idea of this must and this thing was, that by doing that, when you're saying must do, what you're talking about is the curriculum for that group. When you're saying may not do or optional, you're talking about something which is not a part of your curriculum. That is the whole idea of putting this in.
Thank you very much. I think we'll
And the second thing is that, Dr. Parihar was talking about, specifically when I do surgeries, like I'm doing a surgery for optic nerve sheathotomy, or right now I'm doing surgeries where I'm taking the nerves from the leg and putting it into the cornea. It is important that I should know a little bit about the nerves as well. I can't keep on asking. So I can't, when I'm doing ocular trauma, I cannot say I will do the corneal suturing, then I'll call the retina surgeon, then I will call the squint specialist, then I'll call the for the muscles, then I'll call the optic nerve, then I'll call the... So one patient is going to end up with 10 lakhs. Because I do that, I charge 1 lakh for the orbital.
Point taken. So everybody should be a comprehensive ophthalmologist. Yes. Thank you.
Yes.
Thank you very much. We were unfortunate to start about half an hour late. We've handed over again about half an hour late. Sorry for the inconvenience.
Thank you very much.